गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
सो इन द लास्ट क्लास वी हैव कंप्लीटेड द सेकंड यूनिट हाफ पार्ट दैट इज ऑन ऑपरेटर ओवरलोडिंग एंड इन टुडेज सेशन वी विल स्टार्ट ए न्यू टॉपिक विच इज़ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक दैट इज इनहेरिटेंस. सो इट इज़ वन ऑफ द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ ओप्स ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड प्रोग्रामिंग. You have written the assignment, right? In the assignment, you might have seen what are the basic concepts of object-oriented programming system. In that, one of the important concept of object-oriented programming system is inheritance. So, what is inheritance basically? Can anybody tell me what is inheritance? Anybody please respond, what is inheritance?
To derive a class from another class.
To derive a class from another class is called as inheritance, but that is not the actual definition. Acquiring the properties of one class into another class, acquiring the properties and characteristics, whatever it may be. So, acquiring the properties of one class into another class is called as inheritance, right. So, we have different types of inheritance in that is supported in C++. We will go through all these inheritance types of inheritance with one programming example each, right. So, basically we will start our discussion with the introduction to inheritance and then we will see what are the various modes of inheritance we can do. And then we will discuss the types of inheritance and finally we will end up this topic discussing the concept of pure virtual functions and abstract classes. So this is how the agenda for this inheritance class has been designed. So coming to our topic of discussion, inheritance. So, the capability of a class to derive the properties and characteristics from another class is called as inheritance. So, it is an act where you derive or you get the properties and characteristics from another class is called, this is called as inheritance, right. And as we know that this is one of the basic and most important feature of object-oriented programming, we should know the terminology that lies behind this inheritance. So, one of the terminology is the superclass. Superclass, as the name itself says that we have two different classes, right. This is one class from which we derive another class. This is how we write. So, the class whose properties are inherited, that means this is A, let us say that is class A and this is class B. So, I am inheriting the properties of class A to class B. So, the class whose properties are inherited by this by the subclass is called as the superclass. This is called as superclass and it is otherwise called as the base class. So, we have another class called B where we are inheriting the properties from the superclass. So, this class, the class B is called as the subclass or derived class. So, these terms will be used interchangeably. So, whenever we refer to the term derived class, it is nothing but a subclass. Whenever we refer to the superclass, that is nothing but the base class. So, some others they make use of these terms interchangeably. Some others they will make use of superclass and some other people they make use of base class. Like that, derived class and subclass are also used interchangeably. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now we will see the syntax. We will see why this inheritance is required. The only thing, the one and only point that you should remember why we need this inheritance is it is mainly used for the reusability. What do you mean by reusability? Can anybody tell me?
it can be used again and again.
Using the same code.
Right. Using the same code again and again is termed as reusability. Right. Let us take an example which consists of three classes. Right. Group of vehicles. The first class is a bus class, and the second one is the class car, and second one is class truck. Here you can see in the diagram. Right. And assume that we need to create the classes for this bus, car and truck. This is how I have created. And assume that these three classes, the bus, car and truck, all these three classes are having three functions, right? One is the fuel amount, and second one is the capacity, and the third one is the apply brakes. So these three functions are similar in all the classes. Let us assume a case where we need to create three classes, which is bus, car and truck, and assume that all the three classes are having three functions which are common to all the classes, right? Which is fuel amount is one function, capacity is another function, and apply brakes is another function, right? So if we don't have the concept of this inheritance, so what you have to do is you have to create these three classes separately, and you have to implement these three functions separately for each and every class, right? So you have to write the code for fuel amount in bus class, and you have to write the code for the fuel amount in class car, and the same function fuel amount should be rewritten in the class truck also. Similarly, the remaining two functions, you need to repeat the same code, whether it can be a bus class or car class or truck class, you have to repeat the same set of instructions through all these classes, right? So here we have the redundant work. The programmer is having some redundancy, redundant work he need to do. Redundancy means, what do you mean by redundant work? Repetition. We can simply say it as repetition, right? So in order to avoid this redundant work for the programmer, or to reduce the efforts of the programmer, we can make use of the concept called as reusability. That means I write only once, I write the fuel amount code only once. Similarly, I write the instructions that constitute the capacity function only once. I write the code regarding this apply brakes only once. And what I will do is, I will try to incorporate the same functions within the class and the truck. Therefore, I am reducing my efforts. As a programmer, I am reducing my efforts two times. Previously, I used to write the same code for three times, but now I have written only one time, and I can use the concept of inheritance, and thereby I can access, or I can acquire the properties or the functions, these fuel amount, capacity and apply brakes. I acquire these properties into my class car and class truck. This is where the reusability comes into existence. In order to do this type of reusability, that means write once and use any number of times, that is called as reusability, right? So this reusability concept can be implemented in C++ using inheritance, right? So this is how I do it using inheritance. For example, I have a programming language that support inheritance. The previous one is a traditional programming language, that is you make use of C. In C programming language, there is no concept of inheritance. So whenever you write the three structures like bus, car and truck, right, and three programs, bus, car and truck, we have three functions, and you need to copy paste all these three functions for three times. But since the object oriented programming concept supported language such as C++, Java, etc., they have an inbuilt concept which is called as inheritance, where you can acquire the properties of one class into subclasses, any number of classes you can do, right? So we'll see all these types of inheritances with programming examples, don't worry, but this is how we have done here, right? So the disadvantage of the above process, that means when we make use of the traditional programming language which does not support any object oriented programming concepts such as inheritance, the disadvantage is you have to write the same code number of times, therefore you will have some data redundancy. And similarly, when you write the same code again and again, there may be a chance that there is an increase in the error rate. So you may write some errors, right? So in order to avoid these disadvantages or to overcome these disadvantages, we have a concept called as inheritance, which supports the reusability. Right. So for this purpose, what I have done is I have created a generic class. I call this class as vehicle. Right. I create a generic class which is called as vehicle, and in that vehicle I have defined three functions: the fuel amount, capacity, and apply brakes. Now what I will do is I will create three subclasses: the class bus, class car, and class truck. I inherit these three classes from the base class vehicle. So what happens when you do inheritance is these characteristics which are with the class vehicle will be inherited or will be acquired by the subclasses, right? Thereby you can reduce the data redundancy and you can reduce the error rate also, right? Is it clear?
Clear,
yes, sir.
So till now we have seen what inheritance is. A simple definition of inheritance is acquiring the properties and characteristics of one class into another class is called as inheritance. So the class from which you inherit the properties, not you, the class from which the subclass inherits the properties is called as superclass or base class, and the class which inherits the properties from the superclass is called as the subclass or derived class. And after that we have seen the why we require this inheritance concept. Simple answer, the simple and straightforward answer is for the purpose of reusability, they have introduced the concept of inheritance. So in order to reduce the data redundancy, they have introduced the concept of inheritance. In order to reduce the number of errors, they have introduced this inheritance. So these are the different advantages we have by making use of the inheritance concept. Only simple term you should remember is reusability. If somebody questions you what is the main intention of inheritance, means inheritance is implemented in order to implement reusability, right? Is it clear up to now?
Yes, sir.
Now we will discuss what are the various modes of inheritance. Before discussing these modes of inheritance, let us see what should be the syntax for the inheritance, right? What do you mean by syntax? Anybody please tell me what actually is syntax?
How to write
how to write is okay,
declaration, sir.
It is a template.
No, it is not template, it is not declaration. There is a term, there is a synonym for this
structure.
Syntax. No. Right. The syntax of any programming language is called as grammar. Have you not heard of this term initially in the C programming language? Right. So if you take any language, you take the English language, do we have grammar?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
why,
sir.
Why do we use this grammar? What does the grammar say?
The right way of speaking or writing.
Super. The right way of speaking or writing, right? Otherwise, we can also say that it is specifying the rules. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
For example, when should we use the preposition? When should we use the article? When should we use the and? Right. All these things are nothing but the rules that are framed to correctly use that language. Right. So, all the rules that constitute are coagulated and we call it with a common term called as grammar. In the similar way, this is a computer programming language, right? We have seen the natural language, which is English, where we have different rules to correctly articulate the or to correctly speak or write the contents in the English language, right? In the similar manner, we see that these C and C++, Java, Python, all these things are called as programming languages. So these programming languages should also follow some rules, right? Those rules are nothing but the syntaxes. We call it with a special name, right? In the programming language, the rules that we follow in the programming language are called as syntax, right? So simply remember one term: syntax of a programming language is nothing but the rules that we follow in the programming language. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. For example, let us take, how do you declare a pointer, integer pointer? Int star p, right, where p is a pointer variable of type integer. Right. How do you declare an array of size 10, integer array of size 10? I take the keyword
int,
a is the name of the array, and within the square brackets I write like this. And if I want to initialize, I write like this, 10, 20, 30, I close like this. Right. And after this curly brace, I should end every statement in the C programming language with statement terminator, which is nothing but the semicolon, right? So we are, they are specifying some rules. If you want to define or if you want to declare an array of type integer, it should be preceded, the array name should be preceded with the data type int. And after that, you have to give one space, and after one space, you have to specify the name of the array, which is of user choice. And there are also some rules to specify these identifiers, right? And after that, you open a square bracket. Within the square brackets, you have to specify a numeric number, which is called as any numeric number. So how many elements you want to declare the array, that number should be prescribed inside the square brackets. What happens if I don't give this square brackets? Right, let us discuss one more time. Let us say I have given the declaration as int b of. What happens here? Is it a correct statement or does it raise any error?
It raises an error.
What error it will give? Not exact error, I don't want the exact error. Just give me what error it will specify. What is wrong
regarding in size?
Regarding size, super, right. So here the compiler will give an error saying that the array size has not been specified. That means while you declare an array, it is mandatory that you should specify the size of the array. But if you forget, as a user, as a programmer, if you forget to give the size or specify the size here, it will raise an error, right? So if you violate a rule, the rule is saying that you should specify the size of the array while the declaration, at the time of declaration itself. But if you don't, if you violate that rule, I forget to give the size of this array, that means I am violating the rule, at that time you will get the compilation error. So all the syntax errors come under compilation errors. At the time of compilation, the compiler will give an error, right? So this is all about the syntax. That is, can you listen to my voice?
Yes, sir.
Ma, please tell me whether it is clear or not. Why? Because once it has been disconnected, I observed that it is the audio is broken all the time, right? You tell me whether the voice is clear or not.
It's clear, sir.
Okay, sir.
So whenever you find any difficulty in this voice, that means you observe any breakage of voice, you please report me. Okay, sir. Right. Is it clear up to this point? That is what syntax is. That is the reason why, while discussing any concept in the programming language, our first task is to define the syntax. That means we are going to tell you the rules. So this is the rule for declaring an array, this is the rule for declaring an inheritance, this is the rule for declaring a class, this is the rule for declaring an object. All these things you have seen, right? So syntax for defining a class, syntax for declaring an object, syntax for the constructor, syntax for the destructor, syntax for the copy constructor. So everything, every new concept you learn in the programming language, you always start learning it with the syntax only. That means the author is trying to tell us the rules for each and every concept. Similarly, the inheritance will also have the syntax. Not only inheritance, as I told that any concept, any concept you learn in a programming language, you always start it with learning the syntax only, right? So similarly, for inheritance in C++, there exists a syntax, very simple syntax only, right? So for creating a subclass which is inherited from the base class, you should be very clear about this subclass and base class, right? And we have to follow the below syntax, right? So what is that you are doing? You are going to create a new class with the already existing class. The new class which you are creating is called as the subclass, and the class from which you are inheriting the properties is called as the base class, right? So this is the syntax. Since you are creating a new class, what should I start with?
Class name.
Right. So after that, since you are creating a subclass, class should be followed by a subclass name, right? After this class and subclass name, you should write a colon. This is how you inherit the properties of a base class, right? So this is somewhat new concept. Up to here you are very clear, right? Class and class name, we are very much clear. And this is also clear that the subclass body, the body of the subclass should be enclosed within these curly braces, and every class should end with a semicolon. This everybody knows, right? But what you should know at this particular point of time or in this particular syntax is, while you are creating the subclass, I want to tell the compiler that I am going to create this subclass by acquiring the properties of this base class. How you are going to tell the compiler means, after this class and subclass name, you have to add this colon. After colon, you have to specify the axis specifier. What are axis specifiers?
They specify the scope.
It specifies the scope. Super, right? How many axis specifiers are there?
Three.
What are they?
Public, private, and protected.
So this is the first part you should add during inheritance. Actually, this colon specifies the first part, and this axis specifier specifies the second part, and then you have to specify the third part is the base class name, from where you are inheriting the properties. So these three points you have to add in addition to the class creation. So this from here to here, this is called as class creation. We are very much clear about this, right? But after this class name, you have to add these three important points. One is, it should start with a colon, and after that you have to specify the axis specifier, and after that you have to specify the base class from which you are going to inherit the properties. So the subclass name is the name of the class that I have specified, and the access mode is the mode in which you want to inherit this subclass, right? How you are going to inherit the properties of the base class into subclass, that is specified by the access specifier, right? In the next slide we will discuss what are these modes of inheritance. In that you will get a clear idea of what this access specifier will do during inheritance. We know what is the use of this public, private, and protected in general terms, right? But why we are specifying this access specifier during the inheritance means it will have some importance. I will tell you in the tabular form, don't worry. Right. So access mode is the mode, that means we are telling the compiler to acquire this base class either in the public mode, or we are telling the compiler to acquire the properties and characteristics of this base class in the private mode or protected mode. So we have three different modes, right? So it specifies in which you want to inherit the subclass, in what way you want to inherit the subclass from the base class, right? And after that, the base class name is nothing but the name of the base class from which you want to inherit the subclass. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
clear, sir.
Let us take a simple example. This is my base class and B is my derived class. So can anybody tell me the syntax for creating this this particular representation? How can I create this diagram?
Class B.
Super. I am inheriting. What is the subclass name?
B.
B. So I should start my definition with class, and then what is the name of the class? I am inheriting.
B.
Subclass is B. So after B, you have to specify the colon, and after that, you specify the access specifier. Let us take it as public. Right, and then what you have to do?
A.
The base class name.
Yes, sir.
The base class name is nothing but A. So after that, you write something. This is how we create. This is an example of creating a base class. Subclass B from the base class A. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Yes, sir.
Right. So here is an example of creating the inheritance. Right. What is this first statement?
Header file, sir.
Header file.
This one is std. Okay. So I am creating a class. What is the name of the class?
Parent.
So how many data members it is having?
One data member.
It is nothing but the, let us call it as id underscore p, which is called as parent id, right? P stands for parent and id stands for identification, right? So this is the end of the parent class from here to here. After that, what is this one? What is the syntax here I am following? It is nothing but inheritance. Is it right or not?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So what is the child class name or the subclass name?
Child.
So I am creating a subclass child from parent class under which mode?
Public.
Now tell me, what is the data member that is present inside this child class?
Public,
ID,
sir.
ID,
it is ID underscore C, which stands for the child ID, right? But listen carefully, here is the important point you should remember, right? Even though I have defined or declared only one variable under the public section of the child class, since it is inherited, since the child class is inherited from the parent class, it acquires the properties of the parent class also. So we can assume that this id underscore p is also there inside this child class. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now tell me, how many members are there?
Two members.
Right. This is what is important, right? So when you acquire the properties and characteristics from the parent class via using inheritance, you should remember that whatever properties and characteristics are there with the parent class, they are also acquired by the child. Don't assume that id underscore p is present inside this child. It is a virtual assumption, or it is a clearly virtual assumption, that this id underscore p is also present inside the child class. Is also present under the child class, right? That means, what does it mean? Means when you create an object for this child class, right, you can access this id_c, which is a public data member of child, and you can also access id_p, which is a public member of its parent. This is what a inheritance means. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. Virtually, you imagine that in addition to the properties and characteristics that a child class is having, since it is inherited from the parent class, you assume that whatever characteristics and properties are there inside the parent class, they are inherited. That means they also lie inside the child class. This is what you have to remember. It is very important point. Inheritance is everything dependent on this particular property. Right. So, coming to this main function, I have created this object 1. For which class I have created?
Child class.
Object 1 is an object of child class. Right. Now, you can see here. object1.id_c is equal to 7. What is that I am accessing? I am accessing the child id, which is a public data member of child class itself. No objection in this one. So, I am assigning a value of 7 for this id_c. But look at this statement. What I am doing here? I am accessing id_p. id_p. Where is this id_p?
Parent class.
It is a public member of the parent class. So, I am accessing the public member of the private class using which object? Is it the child class object or parent class object?
Child class object.
id_pm.
Parent class object, sir.
This is a parent class object. That means I am accessing the parent class object, parent class member using the child class object. Right. I am assigning a value of 91. This is also valid. Why? Because we have inherited the parent class with the child class. So, if I print this child ID and parent ID, I will get the output as 7 and here I will get the output as 91. Is it clear up to this example?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, you should remember three important points here. How you are going to inherit this one? One class from the another class. So, this line is very important. This one. And after inheriting, you should visually imagine, you should imagine what are the different properties and characteristics. Properties is nothing but data members. Characteristics are nothing but the member functions. So, what are the properties and characteristics of the child class after inheritance? So, you should always remember that the characteristics and data members of the parent class are included inside the child class. So, that is the reason why I am able to access. This is the third point. So, this is the second point, important point, and this is the third important point you should remember. So, I can access the public members of the parent class using the child class object also. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, coming to the modes of inheritance. Modes of inheritance are nothing but when you try to inherit the properties and characteristics of a superclass into a subclass. What access specifier you are using, whether you are using the public access specifier or you are using a private or protected. So, based upon the access specifier which you are using to inherit the parent class into the subclass, we have three modes of inheritance. Can anybody tell me what are these three modes? One is public mode and second one is
protected
mode
and private.
The third one is private mode. Very simple, right? But there exists important points that you should remember here, right? Listen carefully. I'll tell it with an example also, and we'll see the tabular form also, don't worry. So, if we derive a subclass from a public base class, so what is that I am doing here? I am inheriting the base class into a subclass using the public keyword. So that is called as inheriting the subclass from a public base class, right. So what happens to the public members of the base class to when they are in the derived class? What happens to the protected members in the derived class? What happens to the private members in the derived class? This is what we are going to discuss here, right. So let us assume here. So this is my class A and this is my class B. I inherit class B from class A, right. Let us take three variables x, y and z. X is public and y is protected. The same example we will try it with the program also, and assume that z is private. Can you see this annotations here? Are they clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So yes, I am inheriting the class A using the public access specifier. So what happens to X in B? What happens to Y in B? What happens to Z in B? This is what we are going to discuss, right? So when you inherit a class or when you derive a subclass from the public base class, all the public members of the base class becomes the public itself. Who is having the more restrictions? Is it the public, private or protected? More restrictions.
Private,
right. After private, more restrictions will be there for the protected. And okay, public does not have any restrictions, right. Restrictions means who can access the contents. Public can be, public members can be accessed by anyone. Protected members can be accessed by the base class and the immediate derived class only. Private data members, they are never accessed by outside the class. This is the restrictions we have. So most restricted data content or data member or member function is nothing but the private. The second place is occupied by the protected access specifier, and the third place, the no restrictions means public, right. So when you derive a subclass from the base class, when you have an access specifier which is having more restrictions, so the less restricted members will be covered under the more restricted mode, right. We will see it an example, right. So when I create a subclass B with the public superclass A, so X is a public data member of A. So what happens to B, X in B? It becomes a public only. For example, what happens to Y? Y is protected in A, right. The same thing will be continued. Why? Because you should compare this data member mode with the mode with which you are accessing the base class, right. Here the data member is Y is protected, and the mode in which you are accessing or you are creating the subclass from the superclass is the public. So which one is more restricted?
Protected.
Y is
protected.
So the property of this Y will be secured, right. You cannot reduce the security. For that purpose, the Y which is a protected data member of A remains the protected while you are deriving the subclass as a public base class, right. Now compare what happens to the Z. What is Z in private? What is Z in A?
Private.
So you compare this private with public. Which is having more restrictions?
Private.
So the same private will be continued in this. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now we will go with the other part, right? The protected mode, right? If you derive a subclass using the protected base class, now tell me, what happens to the X in B? What is X in A?
Public, sir.
Public. So you compare this public with protected. Which is more restricted?
Protected, sir.
Now tell me what happens to X?
Protected. It becomes
protected, sir. So it becomes protected. Now what happens to Y? What is Y in A? It is protected. And you are inheriting it using the protected only, right? So it remains as it is. So Y becomes protected. And what happens to Z? Z is private in A and you are accessing that Z using the protected inheritance, right? So what happens to Z?
It will remain private, sir.
It remains private. The concept you have to remember here is, whichever is having the more restrictions, that will be the lower restricted data members or member functions will be converted to the more restricted data members and functions. Is it clear? Simple statement. The less restricted data members and member functions will be automatically converted to a high restricted data member and member function. This is what you have to remember. Now, the third mode of accessing, which is nothing but, what is the third mode?
Private mode.
Private mode.
Private. Right. Now, tell me what happens to X in B. So, when I ask the such question, you have to compare this public and private. So, X is a public, which is a less restricted data member. But I am deriving the subclass using a more restricted mode, which is private. So, the public members becomes
private,
sir.
Now, tell me, what happens to protected?
Converted to private, sir.
Converted to private. Why? Because you compare this protected with private. Protected is less restricted than the private. So, I told you one important point regarding this mode of inheritance. A less restricted data member or the member function will be automatically converted into a high restricted data member and member function respectively, right? So, protected and private, compared to that protected and private, private is more restricted. Therefore, even though Y is a protected data member in the superclass A, since you have inherited using the private mode, the protected data member will be converted to private, right? And what happens to Z?
It remains private, sir.
It remains same, right? So, private compared with private, both are same. Therefore, Z becomes private. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
So, what is the difference between the private and protected? Very important. Private.
In protected, the members can be accessed by a subclass.
Super, right. So, in private data members, the private data members cannot be directly accessed in the derived class. Private data members means they cannot be accessed outside the class, whether it is a derived class or child class, whatever it may be. Nothing is accepted, right? So, when you declare a private data member or private member function, those data members and private member functions can be accessed within the class only. You cannot access them outside the class. But protected means it relaxes the private. It is almost similar to that of private only, but it gives some relaxation, saying that the class, the protected data members can be accessed by the class itself and by its derived class only, right? Only parent and child classes can access the protected data members. So, that is a small relaxation that is provided by this protected data members when compared to that of the private data members, right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Clear, sir.
So, this is the example which I have given, right? I have class A. How many data members are there in class A?
Three. Three, sir.
X, Y and Z. As I told that X is a public data member, Y is a protected and Z is a protected. And what is this class B here? It is a child class which is inherited from public, which is inherited from A, and the mode of inheritance is public. So what happens to X?
Public.
What happens to Y in B? It is protected. What happens to Z in B? It is private. So Z is not, since it is private to class A, Z cannot be accessed from class B. That is what we know about this private and protected, right? Let us take another class C, which is derived from class A, and the mode is protected. So what happens to the public member of A? It becomes protected. What happens to the protected member? It becomes protected only. What happens to the private? It remains
private. It is not accessible, sir.
It remains private, that is the reason why it is not accessible from C, right? Now take another example where I am creating class D from class A under private mode. So what happens to all the members? X, Y, Z, everything becomes private only, right? Nothing can be accessed from class D. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
So this is the tabular form of different modes of inheritance, right? So this particular colon, this colon is regarding the base class member access specifier. That means what are the access specifiers of the members that are present inside the base class, and this is the type of inheritance or the mode of inheritance. We can say that it is a mode. So the public members of the base class becomes public when it is inherited from as a public in the public mode, and the protected becomes protected, private remains as it is. Similarly, when we inherit using protected, the public becomes protected, protected remains protected, private remains private. And when you inherit the super class, when you create a subclass using private mode from the super class, the public access member will become the private. Similarly, protected member becomes the private and the private remains private. This is what we have seen in the previous examples. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Right. So this is end of today's session. We cannot start the other topic. Why? Because it involves lot of topics to be covered. So I plan the next topic, that is types of inheritance, which is very, very, very important regarding the theoretical point of view, examination point of view, interview point of view, lab point of view, anything you take, right? You can expect one question from this inheritance, damn sure, right? So that is the importance of these types of inheritance. So I am going to cover the types of inheritance concept in tomorrow's class. Maybe it will not be completed, will take 2 or 3 classes. Is it clear up to this point? So in today's class, we have started our discussion on the introductory concept to inheritance, what inheritance is, why we need this inheritance. We require inheritance to implement the reusability, to reduce the data redundancy, to reduce or to minimize the errors, right? All these are the uses of the inheritance. But one term you should remember regarding this inheritance is reusability. Inheritance is used for reusability. That is the thing you have to remember, right? And after that, we have seen the syntax of inheritance with an example, programming example also. And the next topic which we have covered is the modes of inheritance, 3 modes of inheritance: public mode, private mode and protected mode. And we have seen then a programming example as well as the tabular form which prescribes how the members, different members, public, private and protected members of the base class are going to be converted into the derived class in different modes. How it is going to be converted in the private mode, how it is going to be converted in the protected, similarly public, all these things we have discussed, right? So this is end of today's session. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.